So for the past several months, most of the reviews that I've put out have been Patreon requested. I admit, it's allowed several of my other projects to fall by the wayside, but that's mostly because I just want to get caught up and I'm way behind. I've still got a long way to go. But we're not going to be doing that for the rest of June, for one simple reason. On June the 1st of 2020, my 30th birthday arrived. Now, to some of you, that may not be a big deal. I have a few colleagues that are older than me, and they seem to be fine with it. 30 is certainly not the oldest age there is, and it's probably a testament to how young I actually am that I felt any dread about that day coming. Maybe because, even against my will, I'd sort of internalized that stigma that cartoons are just for kids. I started making videos around the time that I started college, and my first Cartoon Hero review came out when I was 19. Back then, I was definitely one of the younger reviewers out there, and it certainly showed with my skill level. But because of what I specialized in, I was grateful for how young I was. After all, in my mind, it was one thing to be a 20-something who likes cartoons. It's another thing to be a 30-something who likes them. Now, I know that's a stupid way of thinking, but that didn't stop me from instinctively thinking it on some level. Even now, I'm only 30, and yet I feel older than old. I know that eventually that feeling will pass. There are always going to be people who say that I'm too old to care about cartoons. But of course, just saying that doesn't make it any easier. So I think you'll forgive me if I dedicate the rest of this month not to reviews that someone else wanted me to do, but to reviews that are a bit more personal for me. The review subjects for this month aren't just nostalgic, though they certainly do have that going for them. No, for me, this goes back to where this lifetime passion of mine began, and that was way back in my childhood. I think it's safe to say that without these cartoons, I wouldn't have done this for over 10 years. These aren't just nostalgic, in other words. Like it or not, they're a part of me, and they made me who I am today. Of course, I've covered other movies like that before. Part of the reason I joined the Land Before Time Wars collaboration was because I loved those movies as a kid up until I got to the Stone of Cold Fire. But some of the other shows that made me got pushed back in favor of other stuff I wanted to talk about. And I can assure you that until I've run out of stuff to talk about completely, then my reviews will never end. So with that being said, welcome to another edition of Unfinished Business, as we explore my first animated adaptation. I'd say that most of you read The Little Engine That Could as a kid. It's a classic American fairy tale that's been told and retold many times, but its popularity really kicked off when the publishing company Platt & Monk published a version in 1930 that was adapted by Waddy Piper. A name which I loved to say as a kid, and honestly, it's still pretty fun to say now. Just say it out loud to yourself slowly and see if you don't giggle. Which is funny because Waddy Piper doesn't actually exist. It was just the pen name of one of the publishers, Arnold Monk. But we're not here to talk about the book. Basically, much like The Wind in the Willows, because I loved the book as a kid, my parents found me a cartoon version so I could watch that instead of reading it all the time. And like that version of The Wind in the Willows, this version of The Little Engine That Could proved to be a lot more than just an audiobook. It all began with a man named Dave Edwards, who actually started out animating for Yellow Submarine as well as a few commercials. To create his own cartoons, he and a man called Mike Young went over to Cardiff, Wales, and established their own animation company, Serial, and together they made the Super Ted series, which I've heard was pretty big with 80s British kids. In 1991, Serial struck a deal with the Welsh kids cable company, S4C, not to be confused with D4C, to create an animated version of The Little Engine That Could, though theirs was more based on the version with illustrations by Ruth Sanderson. It was first conceived as a short film, and it was released directly to video as one, only clocking in at 30 minutes. And only a few years later, little kid me got a hold of it. Of course, I no longer have that version now, and even if I did, I don't have a VCR that could play it. Besides, even though some sources tell me that it has a DVD version, I could never find one. The creepy-looking 2011 version has a DVD release, but not this one. The only reliable way I could find it was on Amazon Prime Video, but, well, given the luck that I had with recording footage for the Enchanted Adventures review, we won't be getting it from there. Though if you want to watch it, it's apparently free with a Prime membership. And hey, maybe after this video you'll appreciate it as much as I do. This is The Little Engine That Could from 1991. So we open on a book opening, only to see a kid reading a book. The kid's apparently reading about the birthday train, which delivers toys to kids everywhere on their birthday, though his sister says that's a load of garbage. Mostly because it is. The kids really need some kind of mystical figure showing up at their door just to give them presents when they're already getting them from friends and family. This isn't Christmas round two. But for the purpose of this movie, we'll ignore that, as the kid, Eric, is absolutely sure the train will come.
It'll come. I know it will. I know it will.
And trust me, the movie cuts back to him several times to remind us of that. We get our opening title and credits, which also gives us a bit of a preview of what's to come for our little engine, before finally coming to a train yard, which is just opening up for the day. This particular train yard is home to five engines. Georgia, an all-purpose engine. Jebediah, a rusty old engine voiced by Frank Welker. Pete, a gruff old freight engine voiced by Peter Cullen. Farnsworth, a shiny new passenger engine that's also voiced by Frank Welker. And finally we have Tilly, a tiny blue switcher engine voiced by Calf Susie. Gee, I wonder who the main character is. Oh, and she's also got a little bird friend named Chip, voiced by Scott Menville. Yeah, for some obscure TV short that I never would have heard about if I weren't a fan of the book, this has a pretty great cast. I'm not complaining, I'm just kind of surprised. As a switch engine, it's Tilly's job to pull the other engines between tracks, most of whom belittle her because of her size, even though Tilly actually wants to pull an actual train for once. She wants to try and take Jebediah's place pulling the milk train that morning, and Georgia encourages her to give it a shot, but the tower, voiced by Neil Ross, shoots her down immediately. As for Georgia, she's gonna be the one pulling the birthday train, but it's not quite ready yet. No, they need to load all the colorful characters that host the birthday party, including Rollo the Clown and Jeepers the Monkey, voiced again by Frank Welker, Grumpella the Bird, voiced by BJ Ward, Handy Pandy, voiced again by Neil Ross, Stretch, also voiced by Scott Menville, and Missy, again voiced by Cass Susie. Yeah, this has a lot of double casting in it, though Frank Welker has by far the most roles. Though, given his talents, I'm not really complaining. So the birthday train is finally loaded and it sets off, though Tilly is sad that she's not the one pulling it. At first it looks like things are going well, but then Georgia has a blowout and is unable to keep going. She's able to signal for help, however, and Tilly tells Doc, who I guess is a medical engine, and also voiced by Neil Ross, that she's in trouble.
Well, you'll be alright. It's just a bent spunkamunker.
Hey, you laugh, but I bent my spunkamunker a few years ago. Took weeks to pop it back in. Well, no problem. They'll just flag down another engine to pull the train. And luckily, Farnsworth happens to be passing by. Unfortunately, Farnsworth is too full of himself, being a fancy passenger train, to pull the likes of the birthday train, so he just heads off and leaves them stranded.
I pull the likes of you. Indeed.
Little known fact, that's also what the hipster train sounds like. Next, they flag down Pete, but again, he won't pull them because he's too important, having delivered a printing press that morning for the grown-ups to read the newspapers. Wow, they got turned down by Megatron and Optimus Prime. That's gotta be a record. Also, remember when newspapers were important? Man, I really am old. However, with most of the trains down, Tilly tries to volunteer, but Tower doesn't take it well.
No way, no time, not now, not ever, no!
Dude! Take it down a few hundred notches. You're starting to run out of trains at this point. Speaking of which, now it's Jebediah's turn, and he actually sounds like he's going to do it, except he can't, because he's too old and worn down to go over the mountains. Well, at least it's a better excuse than the other two had. Wow. You know, I know this was part of the book, but I didn't realize how much of the movie this took up. We're 10 minutes from the end at this point. So now there's only Tilly left, even though she has to sneak past the sleeping tower to do it. And even when she gets there, the toys are kind of skeptical that she can even make it. But of course, Tilly thinks she can.
I think I can.
Which the movie actually uses as the baseline for a song. The only one in the movie, surprisingly. But it's a pretty good one. However, after a while the song gives out as Tilly starts to get tired. And even worse, some random wolf comes out to smack talk her.
Turn back, you're too little. You can't do it.
Again, Frank? I hope he got paid well for this, man. He does have a little wolf with him who's voiced by Cass Susie, who thinks she can do it. So basically it's Tilly encouraging herself to keep going. And just as we see the grade that Jebediah was afraid to go up, we get another Frank Welker cameo in the form of an eagle who basically tells her the exact same thing. But Tilly presses on, only for a boulder to strike the bridge she's going over, and the train almost ends up collapsing along with it, but they barely make it to safety, even though they lose a car in the process. However, their troubles aren't over yet. Oh, come on, even the mountains belittling her? That's going too far. Although, if I saw a mountain that looked like that and had Peter Cullen's voice, I'd probably turn back myself. But Tilly keeps going, only for the mountain to just drop an avalanche on her. Well, kid, I hope your birthday gifts were worth all the sacrifices.
Millions are dead!
Also, hang on. Eric's picture book has the events of the movie in it. Well, if that's the case, then I guess he does know she makes it in the end. Although it looks pretty bad at first, considering they're all buried under a huge snowdrift. But eventually, Tilly wakes up, gives it one more push, and they finally punch their way out. And, on a reprise of Nothing Can Stop Us Now, the birthday train finally makes it down the mountain. Tilly's finally achieved her dream, and Eric and all the other kids now have gifts and good food to eat. So I guess this is a birthday train for everybody then. Anyway, that was The Little Engine That Could from 1991, and, you know, even though it's a movie that means a lot to me, when all's said and done, did you really expect me to turn around and say that I hated it? I mean, I try to be objective, guys, but I'm not heartless. Of course, it's not a perfect movie. For such a short film, the movie actually has some pacing issues. We don't get started on Tilly's journey until the last third of the movie, and yes, I know that's part of the book, but instead of cutting back to Eric, we should have been cutting back to Tilly. Have a scene where she talks to Chip about how much this means to her. It might make her journey all the more worth it. And the concept of the birthday train is something that makes less sense the more you think about it. This is definitely a kid's movie in that regard. However, with that said, I still think it's a really good kid's movie. I don't think anyone was begging for The Little Engine That Could to get an adaptation with this effort put into it, but I'm glad it exists. It's got some pretty incredible animation and voice acting for the time, and despite the pacing issues, I still think it's definitely going to please kids who are fans of the book. It certainly got me to leave my parents alone for a bit when I was a kid, so I'm certain it made them happy. I may have said before that Schoolhouse Rock was what got me interested in animation as a kid, and that may have codified it, but I think that between this and The Wind in the Willows movie I've reviewed before, this was the original starting point. Well, either that or the Dr. Seuss videos that were basically glorified motion comics, but The Little Engine That Could was one of the first fully animated cartoons that held my attention as a kid, and that would start a lifelong hobby for me. This version of the story is pretty obscure nowadays. Chances are the only way you're going to get it today is on Amazon Prime, and who knows how long that'll last. But if you can find it, it's definitely worth checking out. If nothing else, then as a piece of animation history. Or at least my history with it. Up next, it's time for a field trip to one of the first animated shows I really got into as a kid. Seatbelts, everyone!
There's an old black train a-comin', scraping down the iron. You don't need no ticket, boys, it'll take you when it's time. Wait a minute, stranger, ain't you someone's son? How'd you get to this depot here? It ain't where you belong. We will pass a graveyard with stones worn by the years. The train will stop a minute, but don't let it leave you here. Engineer's my brother, the coachman is my friend, and we'll get you more acquainted by the time we reach the end.